Welcome to one of our present here for today's technical session on individual IT returns including foreign TP. So before we start the session, this small announcement. So we have budget analysis on 6th July this month, Saturday, from 2:30 onwards in Christ College Auditorium. So budget analysis for 3 to 4 hours. It is a free program. Members and non-members, all are welcome. And their clients also, you can invite them also. Now I request our Bangalore branch chairman, CA Sir Upadhya, to please escort today's speaker, Krishna Upadhya S. We welcome you, sir. A small introduction about Krishna Upadhya. He is a graduate in commerce from Bangalore University and a fellow member of ICAI. Academically, he holds the accolade of having cleared all the CA exams in the first attempt with All India 27th rank in CA final exam. So when it comes to work profile, so previously he was working in ENY, advising clients in matters ranging from domestic taxation, DTAA, exchange control and transfer pricing matters. He is currently a partner in Upadhyaya & Associates and handles audit and assurance and heads the direct taxes and consulting team in Advait Consulting LLP. His areas of work involve handling corporate and non-corporate audit, assurance, valuation and certification. He is also engaged in handling direct tax related compliances for corporate and non-corporate clients. His experience also includes handling direct tax litigation to the clients, including appearing before ITAT, handling various tax due diligence in the course of mergers and acquisitions. He is also involved in advising various clients in India, entry strategy, cross-border tax structuring and repatriation strategy advisory. He also works on advising clients on transfer pricing strategy, assisting in preparation of transfer pricing documents and also appears before various authorities on transfer pricing litigation. And his other areas of interest, he has keen interest in reading and research about direct taxes. He also contributed various articles to KSCA and ICAI journals. He has also been a speaker at Bangalore branch of ICAI and ICSA. He is also a part of team that is involved in bringing out a newsletter titled TaxWire, containing regular updates and analysis on developments in the income tax sphere. Apart from taxes, he also has keen interest on current affairs, environmental protection and music. With this brief introduction, we welcome you once again to today's session, sir, and over to you.
I thank the Bangalore branch, the chairman and the managing committee members for inviting me for this talk. So this topic is going to be slightly generic. It said individual ITR including foreign taxpayers. So I thought let me cover what I felt was relevant considering the season in which we are, where we will be dealing with filing of individual tax returns largely, maybe for the next 1.5 months. Assuming that due dates will be extended, because that's what a lot of them are hoping, considering the fact that due dates for furnishing 24Q was extended and thereby the Form 16s got delayed, the due date for that was also extended. So there is a small possibility that the due date for filing of individual tax returns can be extended from 31st July to whatever date. Not very sure on that. So I thought whatever is relevant considering that season, I'll take you through a few things. Also talking about how a foreign national or a non-resident having incomes in India, an individual primarily, what are they expected to do in terms of their tax filings in India. So roughly this will be the outline of what I'll be talking about. I'll be talking about taxability of income, a general overview of how the Income Tax Act works in terms of taxability. Then income tax returns, applicability and what's new in the returns that have been notified for the current assessment year. Then taxability for non-residents, like I said, I'm focusing only on the individuals. I've covered a little bit of independent personal service and dependent personal service related topics, because there could be individual non-residents for whom these articles of the DTAA will apply. And I'll be happy to take questions at the end of the session, or if there's anything in between you would want to ask me, dispute with me, I'll be more than happy to stop and probably discuss on that. Firstly, on the taxability of income, starting from residence, I think this is the first part of determining one's taxability and the related things. So the first thing is, you know, I've tried to capture this in a flowchart to make it very simple. So firstly, has somebody been resident in India, residing in India for more than 182 days? If the answer to that is a yes, they become a resident. If the answer to that is a no, then the question arises, have they been in India for more than 365 days in the last 4 years and more than 60 days in the current financial year? If again the answer to that is a yes, they become a resident again. If the answer to that is a no, they become non-resident. Then there's an exception, there's another rule, which is if an individual leaves India for as a member of a crew of a ship or for employment outside India, the threshold slightly change. The second threshold of 60 days doesn't apply, so that again goes into the 180 day criteria. There again, if they have been in India for more than 182 days, then they become resident, otherwise they become non-resident. I think this is pretty clear. This is one of the basics at which the taxation starts, by determining why does one become a resident or a non-resident. Then, as you are aware, there is this peculiar concept of ordinary resident and not ordinary resident in our tax law. So, which again is pretty standard and pretty basic. I think I just wanted to brush all our memories with this rule so that I set the context. That is why I am covering these. Then again, if there's somebody has been a non-resident for 9 out of 10 years or has stayed for less than 729 days in 7 years, the answer to that is a yes, they become resident and not ordinarily resident. If the answer to that is a no, it's a negative rule here. So if the answer to that is a no, then they become resident and ordinary resident. What happens based on this distinctions of ROR, RNOR, NR, I've covered in the next slide. Where section 5 talks about the scope of total income. So when does a certain income become taxable for an individual is captured in section 5, which I have tried to put in this table. Global incomes are taxable for ordinary residents. I think that's a straightforward rule. Any income that is deemed to accrue arise in India, that accrues arises in India, deemed to accrue arise in India, received or deemed to be received in India, is taxable in India, is what section 5 says. Considering that for an ordinary resident, all these are taxable in India. For a not ordinary resident, income which accrues arises outside India is not taxable in India. For a non-resident, again, what accrues arises outside India is not taxable. But for an ordinary resident, what accrues and arises outside, if it is derived from a business controlled in India or a profession which is set up in India, can also be taxed in India. For a non-resident, obviously anything that is accruing arising outside India is not taxable in India. So this is the rule of taxation. So that is why in the same order, the first order is to determine whether one is a resident, ordinary resident, not ordinary resident, and then a non-resident. Then we look at where are these incomes accruing, arising. Deemed to accrue, deemed to arise is another concept that the income tax law talks about, which is there in section 9. Then once that is determined, then based on the residential status, the taxation is arrived at. I'll skip section 7, not very important, so I'll directly get into filing of tax returns, forms, their applicability, and what's new in the current year forms. So before that, section 139 makes it mandatory to file tax returns in India. 139.1 says that every person having an income taxable in India is required to file their tax returns. 139.3 talks about the loss returns. 139.4 talks about the belated returns. 139.5 talks about the revised returns. I have not touched upon the other subsections of 139 because that itself is in. So most of them are trust returns and NGO returns and returns of institutions which are exempt under section 10, 11, so, and political parties, so on and so forth. So since our topic for today's discussion is individuals, these are the four relevant subsections of section 139 which talks about filing of return of income. Rule 12 of the Income Tax Rules 1962 gives the various forms in which income tax returns are to be filed. Rule 12 gets amended typically every single year. The board gets this amendment to cover following two things. One, if there's any change in the law, they want to incorporate that in the written as well, obviously, so they make an amendment. Second, in case the department believes that there's certain information that they require because of the change in dynamics of the way things are happening, so again they make an amendment in the Rule 12 to bring out new forms and notify them every year. Typically what used to happen till a few years back, this itself was extremely contentious. Every year notifying the return itself used to take a lot of time. As you are aware, there were a lot of writs filed in one of the years where they said that the returns were notified extremely late. They were notified as late as end of May, beginning of June, and the due date was still July. So the courts came heavily on the tax department and said that in case you delay notifying the returns, please delay the due dates as well. Otherwise, if a person is wanting to file his tax return on the 1st of April, he should be made available in the returns. That is what the courts said, especially the Delhi High Court. After that, I have captured a trend of notification of the forms. If you could see that, the trend has kept on getting better. 2013, 1st May it was notified, and subsequently in 13 is when the Delhi High Court said this, I think just before 2013, so they said that. That is why you see that in 14 they notified it on 1st April, subsequently 15th April, 30th March. So this year's return were notified and the filing utilities were not available, but it was notified on 1st April 2019. So then moving on to how does one have to verify the return? As you all are aware, so once a return is chosen to file, then it is filed. There is a concept of verifying the return. That verification could be by way of using a digital signature, using a EVC or an Aadhaar OTP, or by signing the ITR acknowledgement ITRV and sending it to the CPC. So typically all those for whom audit under section 44AB is applicable, they are mandated to verify the return using the digital signatures. For persons who are not having business incomes which are auditable, that is applicability of 44AB, and those persons are super senior citizens, for them the paper form of return is still allowed. They can file a paper form of return as well. For all others, the paper form of return has been dispensed with, that is not applicable. And for everybody, the three options that are available other than those cases where 44AB is applicable are, you can either do a Aadhaar OTP verification, EVC based electronic verification code based verification of the returns, or you can use a digital signature, or lastly you could either print the ITR V, sign it and send it to the CPC and it gets verified. But a peculiar thing has started happening in the current year. If at all you have already filed returns, you would have noticed that ITRV, the day it is filed earlier, used to be a very simple ITRV which captures the income. This year, at the bottom of the ITRV, they have started saying that this acknowledgement is not an acknowledgement of having filed the returns, is what is a line that they have brought. What happens is, subsequently, let's say, I presume, so most of the returns that we did either the Aadhaar OTP or the EVC or the digital signature. The ones that we did which none of these three were used and ITRV was sent, I presume what will happen is, once the verification at the CPC happens, the acknowledgement changes again and says that now this has been verified and hence the process has been completed. So please take note of that. There could be instances where you file a return, the acknowledgement comes out, the client signs it, and they start giving it into bankers and various other places where they are expected to give their tax returns. There is a possibility that the bankers can ask that, no, these returns are not yet verified, can you please get them verified and give us a copy of the verified ITRV. So this is an additional process that could probably become a little bit of a trouble for all of us, because as professionals, what we would generally do is we file the returns, ask the either the client to send it to the CPC or we just send it to the CPC and then forget it. So until the 143-1 comes and we see that there is a difference, we probably never track them. So this year you cannot do that, you will have to track it till it is verified. Otherwise the ITRV clearly says that this is not an acknowledgement of having filed the return. I don't know why they chose to do that, but yeah, that is how it appears. As on the day how the ITRV looks. Then coming to the forms, these are the forms that are there for the current year, which typically was there even for the last year. ITR 1 is called the Sahaj. I'll get into detailing of ITR 1, 2 largely, because 3 and 4 also. But 1 and 2 predominantly for individuals not having business income. I've covered the applicability a little later, so I'll just keep it for now. 1 to 7 are the returns. 1, 2, 3 and 4 are applicable for individuals. And 5 is for persons other than individual, HUF, company and those filing ITR 7. 6 is for companies and 7 is for those who are claiming exemptions and filing return under subsection 4A, 4B, 4C, 4D, 4E or 4F of 139. So let me get into ITR 1 search. The applicability goes something like this. If an individual has income from salary or pension, income from one house property and no brought forward losses or loss to be carried forward. There should not be a loss that you brought forward from the previous year or a loss that you're carrying it forward from this year onwards. If at all that is there, then ITR 1 is not applicable. So 1 is applicable only without that. Then income from other source except for windfall gains like lotteries, racehorse, and there should not be any losses under the other sources head. Or agricultural income is up to rupees 5000 for that year. Only in those circumstances ITR 1 is applicable. So in all of the circumstances ITR 1 is not applicable. So whom all it is not applicable to? It is not applicable to not ordinarily residents or non-residents. It's applicable only to ROR, that is resident and ordinary resident, having the incomes that I just mentioned in the previous slide. Then if they have claimed any relief under 90, 90A, 91, again ITR 1 is not applicable. If their agricultural income is more than 5000, it's not applicable. Another thing, if the total income is more than 50 lakh, again not applicable. This is another interesting thing. If they are a director in a company, ITR 1 is not applicable. Why? I will tell you later when I talk about what's new in the forms. They have invested in unlisted equity shares, again not applicable. Please make note of this, very important. There could be circumstances where you have a salaried individual whose income is below 50 lakhs, who has not claimed any of the relief under 1990 and 91, but and also he is not a director, but he might have made a small investment in an unlisted private limited company which, you know, maybe one of his relatives floated or one of his friends did or anything. In that circumstances also ITR 1 is not applicable. Again, there is a reason why it has been done so, because in other forms they have brought out some reporting requirements. So then they have dividend from domestic company which are in excess of 10 lakh, which are taxable basically, up to 10 lakh it is exempt. And they have assets including financial interest located outside India. Let's say there could be circumstances where there was an individual who worked outside India for a while. They continue to maintain a small balance in an account which is lying outside India. They might have made some small mutual fund kind of investments in those countries. They've come back to India, ROR, resident, ordinary resident. You might presume that all's well, so I'll use the ITR 1, but you can't do it because they have assets outside India and for whom ITR 1 might not be applicable. So you will have to use the other ITR forms that may be applicable. Then if they have any incomes under 68, 69, 69A, unexplained cash credits, unexplained investments, unexplained cash, etc. Again, ITR 1 is not applicable in those circumstances. So what's new in ITR 1? Firstly, earlier if you all might recollect, the salary was just a single line reporting. There was no breakdown of salary. That's one of the reasons why 24Q, the ETDS filing for salaries were revised this year, whereby 24Q enabled the employer to give the breakdown of salary very clearly, where taxable perquisites, exempt perquisites, taxable allowances, exempt allowances were asked in detail, and it was also mandated that Part B of the Form 16 also should be downloaded and issued to the employees from Traces portal itself. As a continuation to that, what has been done in the ITR form also, that kind of detailing of salary as per 17.1, perquisites as per 17.2, profit in lieu as per 17.3 have been asked to be provided in detail. One of the reasons why it was brought out, I was told, is that there used to be a lot of perquisites which never got reported in the ITR, and it was just a single, you know, accumulated salary number that was reported. In order to avoid that and get a little more information about what kind of components are there in the salary, department wanted to do this. Then, in line with the change in the taxation rules, wherein standard deduction was introduced, they have brought out a column for that as well. So that is the change that has happened in ITR 1. Moving ahead, again in line with the change in the taxation, the tax rates, the CESS, there is a revision where 4% CESS, health and education CESS has been introduced in place of 2% and 1% which was there earlier. And ATTTB got introduced, as you all are aware, where 50,000 up to 50,000 rupees on all interests on interest from banks, whether it is term deposits, non-term deposits, there's a reduction of 50,000. So there's an additional column that has been provided for it. And then the income from other sources, in that section, there was no breakdown of interest, you know, which was given. It just used to say interest. Now they have, you know, broken it down and asked you to report it separately as income from savings account, income from deposits, income from tax refund, family pension, any other. When you choose any other, the column next to it gets enabled where you are expected to give a description of that. So which you can see there in the screen, it says description if any other selected. So this kind of detailing is expected to be given. So I can only presume this is for more transparency in reporting why they have brought it out. So these are the changes that have been done in the ITR 1. Moving ahead, applicability of ITR 2, for all those to whom ITR 1 is not applicable, you will have to look at whether ITR 2 is applicable. The applicability is whatever incomes I just said there, which is salaries, house property, other sources, excluding other sources, not excluding anything. So when those are there, apart from that, if there is income from more than one house property, capital gains and other sources including the windfall gains, which is the lottery and horse races or race horses, either way, both the cases, then ITR 2 will become applicable. So for all those individuals for whom there is no business income, typically ITR 2 becomes applicable. Moving ahead, what's changed in ITR 2? Like I said, in ITR 1, the salary breakdown is asked, standard deduction is asked, which is same as what I already explained. Apart from that, like I said, in ITR 1, it excluded all those individuals who are either directors in a company or held investments in unlisted private limiteds. That is being done because there is an additional requirement that has been brought out. So here in ITR 2, you are expected to give all those cases where such individuals are directors in a company. You have to give the name of the company, PAN of the company, whether shares are listed or unlisted, and the DIN that they carry. So you are expected to give all this in ITR 2. And then you are also required to give, if the such taxpayer held any unlisted equity share investment anytime during the year, you are expected to give the entire details of what is the name of the company, what is the PAN, what is the opening balance of number of shares and value, what is the purchase during the year in terms of number of shares as well as value, sale, number of shares and value, and the closing balance. So this, I think, becomes a little more important for you to understand. So there could be circumstances where clients might not report this to you because there is no way in which sometimes you can determine it prima facie. It's important that if there is a questionnaire or a checklist that you maintain typically for asking your clients this data, you please include these details as well, because non-reporting could lead to a lot of consequences. So it is better to be safe in that aspect and ask the client to furnish this detail so that you clearly make that reporting in the ITR form. So then moving ahead, what other change in ITR 2, which is also changes in ITR 3 and 4, which is if there is a tenant who has deducted TDS under 194IB, just to refresh your memory about what 194IB is, if there is an individual for whom 44AB is not applicable and they are paying rent in excess of 50,000 rupees every month, then they are expected to deduct TDS even on such rents. that they'll have to report it using their PAN itself. So there's no requirement for TAN there. So such, if I'm a recipient of such an income where my tenant has deducted TDS under section 194 IB, I'm required to report the PAN and the details of that tenant as well. And 194I also, which was always there, what they have done is they have made the TAN reporting mandatory. While it was not mandatory earlier, that field was not mandatory, they have just bought it as a mandatory field right now. Where in case there is a deduction of tax source under section 194I, then reporting the TAN of such deductor has been made mandatory. Then like I said, separate reporting for each kind of interest incomes has been brought up, and the other things on education cess, health and education cess. One interesting thing, earlier till last year, if you remember, you were expected to give the jurisdiction of the assessing officer. This year the entire field has been dispensed with. You don't have to give the jurisdiction of the assessing officer at all in the income tax return. So what are the challenges that could come? One, there might be circumstances where when you took the PAN, you had given a certain address, the jurisdiction got aligned with that. Subsequently, you changed the address, you have been continuously reporting that in the ITR form. And in the ITR, you have been using the new address. But you never looked up to it and got it changed in the PAN records. Then what will happen? The jurisdiction wouldn't have gotten changed. This year, what will happen is, that jurisdiction will be considered final. What is there in the profile settings in your income tax portal? Once you log in and go into profile, what jurisdiction is appearing there will be considered final. In case you want, let's say, speedy disposal of some grievances that you have, let's say there's TDS credits were not given correctly, or you wanted a 154 to be done, etc., etc., please make sure that in the PAN record the address is updated so that automatically your correct jurisdiction appears in the income tax portal, so that in case of circumstances where CPC pushes it out of their domain and jurisdiction to the jurisdiction of the assessing officer, then it goes into the right hands and you don't have to run pillar posts to get things done, and you can go and approach the correct assessing officer. So this is another thing. Maybe you can look at doing it parallelly, either before filing the return or after filing the return also. But please make sure that that bit of information is updated. Please don't presume that the minute you put certain address in the income tax return, it automatically goes into the right jurisdiction. It is not so. They are trying to tell you that please update the profile records with us so that your address that you are displaying in the return is aligned with the address that is there in the profile. That is the reason why, in order to avoid that confusions of one jurisdiction being there in the portal and one other you being reporting in the ITR, such things shouldn't continue. For that reason, they have removed the jurisdictional reporting in the ITR form. So moving ahead, what used to happen is that in case you had a capital gains from selling of a property, immovable property in particular, you were to declare it in the capital gains head in the capital gains columns, but they never asked you the buyer's details in detail, right? In the current year form, they have asked the buyer details also, where name of the buyer, PAN of the buyer, percentage of share in case the buyers bought it as co-owners, and the amount, address, PIN code, everything is asked. This is to make sure that when somebody has bought it, so is it declared, is sufficient incomes available in their hands also to make suitable assessments in their hands. So they are asking information from the seller as well. So that is an additional reporting that you will have to be doing. 54EC got amended, so in line with the amendment in 54EC, there is a change in the ITR form also. As you are aware, 54EC is now restricted only for selling of immovable properties and not any other long term capital assets, sale of any other long term capital assets. So again, another change which is to align with the section 50C amendment that was brought out. 50C made it that in case the difference between the value at which you sold the property and the fair market value is within 5%, you still can adopt the sale value. So that change happened in 50C. So they have aligned the same thing in the income tax return as well. Next, moving ahead, as you all are aware, listed shares, taxation was brought in by way of an amendment in the previous year. So to capture that amendment and reporting on that, ITR form has been amended to capture that details as well here. This is an interesting thing. In case of agricultural incomes, you just had to mention it in the exempt incomes column till now. You did not have to do any other reporting at all. But in the current year, what they have done is they have broken this down into saying that how much is your gross earning from agricultural income? What are your expenditures? What are the unabsorbed losses, if any, that you brought forward? What are the net agricultural income? And they are also asking you details of the land from which you earned this agricultural income. So what is the name of the district, pin code, measurement of the land, whether the land is owned, leased, etc., etc. So these are the kind of details that they are asking. This is applicable in case where the agricultural income declared in the return is more than 5 lakh rupees. The net agricultural income is more than 5 lakh rupees. Typically, if you've had experiences of assessments of agricultural income, they were already asking this information during assessments. They used to ask the land records of that land, what are the crop information there, what are the documents available to prove the crop information, etc. That they have brought it into the return itself so that it gets captured at the time of filing of the return. So that is an interesting change that has been brought out. Typically, I don't think so any of us ever asked this information at the time of filing of returns. Now it becomes kind of mandatory for us to do. So again, I go back to the point I was making earlier. If there is a checklist or some kind of a template that you maintain to collate data from the clients, please add this also into that so that you don't miss them. So this is an approach I always keep advocating, to ensure that we discharge our responsibilities quite well, which is try and maintain a template or a checklist of all the information that you need to collate with the client so that it becomes easy for you to get them at one instance probably, and also you don't miss out on any of this, because as and when the forms keep getting, you might be using a lot of automated softwares that are available for filing today, but at the same time not all of these fields are mandatory. So there is a chance that something is not mandatory but reporting was a requirement because it was applicable for that client of yours. But unfortunately, you might have missed it in oversight, or you might have missed it in the pressures of completing the work. So in order to avoid that, I suggest that you maintain some kind of a checklist or a template where you can capture all this information. Then moving ahead, what's the change for non-residents? In case of taxpayers who are non-residents, no further information were asked till now. Now they are asking what is the jurisdiction of the residents and what is the tax identification number that have been allotted to them in that country. So that's an additional requirement that has been brought up. With extremely oiled kind of a information exchange that India has actually gotten into, so this information becomes extremely important for the tax department, because once a tax identification number is available with them, so it becomes very easy for them to seek information from the foreign jurisdiction whenever they want one. So for that reason, they are asking this information as well. Apart from that, in case if a taxpayer is an individual, he is a citizen of India and a PIO, but he is a non-resident. So in that case, so please mark this. In case they are foreign nationals, this detail is not required. Only in case they are citizens of India or persons of Indian origin, then you have to give the number of days of stay in the previous year in number of days, as well as in the last 4 years. So what's the logic? I couldn't make real logic out of this, but anyway, the detail is asked, maybe you will have to collate and give it. So till here, what I tried to do is brush up your knowledge on residential rule, then scope of total income, and then applicability of forms, typically for individuals, ITR 1 and 2. 3 and 4, pretty simple. So I will go back to the table that I had to talk about 3 and 4. 3 is applicable for individual HUF having incomes from profits of business or profession. 4 is applicable where you are declaring incomes in the presumptive basis. So that's it. So those two are pretty simple. 1 and 2 had a little bit of things for us to debate, and hence I brought it up. 3 and 4 have nothing else, and no major changes have happened. Whatever I quoted here, which are applicable for 3 and 4, continue to be changed in those forms as well. Next, I thought I'll highlight another aspect on foreign tax credits. So there could be instances where there are individuals who have certain investments and on which there are incomes that are being generated from outside India, and there are foreign taxes which have been either withheld or paid on that. In those circumstances, how do you report them in the return, and how do you do tax computation? Firstly, rule 128 of the income tax rule talks about foreign tax credits. This rule got introduced since 1/4/2017, if I recollect correctly. The rule also says that the foreign taxes means taxes covered under the DTAA. Each DTAA explains what tax means as per that DTAA. So those are the taxes that are allowed to be credited while you compute the taxes of a person who has doubly taxed income. And FTC is available only for residents. It's not available for the non-resident taxpayers who are required to file returns in India. Then credits are available in the year in which such incomes are offered to tax in India. There could be differences in received accrual in the source country and in the residence country, let's assume India. In those circumstances, in whichever year those incomes are taxable, foreign tax credits are available in that particular year. In a circumstance where the incomes are split over 2 years for taxation, the tax credit also needs to be split over the 2 years. In case there is a disputed tax credit in such source jurisdiction, there is a dispute on the tax, that will not be available as credit in India. And such foreign taxes are allowable as credit for taxes, surcharge, incest. They are not available for interest, penalty and fees. Fees are 234F and things like that. So it's not available for that. And it is restricted to a maximum of the foreign taxes paid or the tax on such income in India. So whichever is least, that much is the foreign tax credit that is available. FTC is also available if such income is being taxed under MAT or AMT. In case such incomes are being taxed on minimum alternate tax or AMT, while not applicable for individuals, AMT could be in few circumstances. But in case there is anything, foreign tax credits are available for them as well. What are the documents that are required for you to claim foreign tax credit? One, there should be like we have a tax return here and an acknowledgement of having filed that. Similar one, if there is anything available in that country, that becomes a basis for you to claim the foreign tax credit. Or if there is a statement of withholding, like our form 16, 16A, etc., 16B, if there is anything equivalent in that particular country, that is the other document that could become a proof of claiming the foreign tax credit. Another important thing, if at all you are claiming a foreign tax credit, please make sure that you file Form 67, which is an online filing, and do this filing just before you file the income tax returns. What does a Form 67 ask? Form 67 merely asks, what are the country in which you've had incomes sourced outside India? What are those incomes? How much is the tax that have been deducted? There is a table where you need to choose which jurisdiction, what are the income and what is the tax credit. Then they ask you two other questions. One, is this spread over more than 1 year in India? If yes, then you have to say which are the years in which it is being spread over. Second question it asks is it a disputed tax credit? If you say yes, you are telling that you are not able, you will not be claiming that credit. Please be careful with that. In case you are saying it's not a disputed credit, you are allowed to claim it. File this Form 67. Currently, there is no linkage between 67 and your ITR, but at the processing validation, they might have put that. You are not yet aware of it. Again, this got introduced in the last year, so just 1 year has happened with this. Our experiences with this has been smooth, so there are not much complications. But please make sure to file Form 67 before filing the income tax returns. Next, I've captured some prerequisites, just food for thought. What all you could probably do before you file tax returns for an individual. Make sure that you determine all the sources of income. You would all be doing all this. Make sure that all incomes are captured. Next, compute the total income after giving all the rebates, exemptions, deductions that are there. Choose the right kind of ITR form. Fill all the details which are mandatory. Mostly the department utility which is available has all those validation rules. Automatically, if you have not filled something, it will throw an error. So it will prompt you to do. Or if you are using a third party software which, you know, kind of integrates the filing and the computation of tax, that will have those pre-validation rules. So, but there, like I said, there could be some things which are not mandatory, but reporting them is required. So in those circumstances, please be careful. Check the 26 years to ensure that all tax credits which ought to have come to you have come. In case there is a difference, and you have recourse to such deductor, please go back to them and ask them to make sure that they file the ETDS returns and or rectify the ETDS returns and the tax credits are available to you. In case the PAN is not registered in the portal, register them. In case it is done, you just can continue. Provide email IDs and phone numbers of the clients preferably, because a lot of communication these days goes into both of these. If you have mechanisms which you have built where you can collate all this and you do some kind of analysis to make sure that you give the responses on time, you can probably give your own email IDs and phone numbers. If not, my suggestion is to give the client's phone numbers and email IDs so that they are responsible about it and they track that. Because it becomes humongously impossible for, let's say if you are filing a large chunk of individual clients' returns and all communications start pouring into a mailbox, it is impossible for you to track them. So it is better that you give the mail IDs and contact details of the client. Or at least you could do an alternate. You could do the mail ID of the client and the phone number of yours or vice versa. So that at least one communication is tracked by, or rather the communication is tracked by two different people at any point of time. Then like I said, update the address details very correctly in the profile as well as get it changed in the PAN records in case you have a change in address, so that the jurisdiction is correct. Link the Aadhaar and PAN to e-verify the return. Like I said, this year, wherever possible, please use EDC and Aadhaar. Otherwise, your process of filing gets extended by one more step, which is you need to track ITRV reaching the CPC, you having confirmation that it has reached. Only then your acknowledgement becomes complete. So in order to avoid that, use an Aadhaar OTP or an EDC which immediately e-verifies your return. This is another thing that has been brought out, which there is nothing in the rules, there is nothing in any of their judicial powers, but they have done it like always they do, which is pre-validation of bank account. In case you have a refund of taxes that you have paid to come into your account, if you think that the refunds are going to come provided you have filed your returns and 143-1 is generated, please don't think so. It will come only if you have pre-validated the bank account in the portal. While pre-validation is an extremely simple process, so you have to just put the account number, the name, the PAN, etc. that gets auto-populated. You just give the IFSC code and request for a pre-validation. It goes back to the CPC for pre-validation. We have no clue how the validation rules work. I have had instances where the name records as per the bank records and the PAN is exactly matching. The PAN is updated both at the bank level as well as in the portal, the right PAN is there. Still a pre-validation failure has come. You raise a grievance, they say submit it again, there must be some difference. So in fact, I today itself tweeted to the income tax department, hoping they will give a response. I haven't got one till now, asking that, can you please let us know what is the validation tool you are using? Are you trying to match first name, middle name, last name in the exact order? Or is there any other way in which you are doing it? Because it's a complete black box today. If the pre-validation fails, your refunds are not going to come. This is not just applicable for individuals, it's applicable for everybody. So from 1st March 2019, they have stopped giving any other form of refunds other than direct credit into the bank account. And they have made pre-validation mandatory. So please, wherever there are refunds to be received, please make sure that the pre-validation is done so that the refunds don't get rejected. I have a practical case. I think I should share this with you. Return is filed. 143-1 is generated, exactly matching, there is no difference. The refund amount is determined. Refund not yet credited. Pre-validation is successful. Okay. So I raised a grievance in the portal stating that all steps are taken. Pre-validation is successful. 143-1 has come. There are no past demands. This refund is rightfully, legally due to me. What should I do? They gave a response. In a day they closed the grievance saying that apply for a refund reissue. Maybe it has failed. I go to the refund reissue. It says no refunds have failed in the past. So I have no clue how to proceed further. You call the helplines that are there. I think you all have experience of it. They give template answers. They have a certain template in which they have to answer you. They just answer in that template and they ask you to drop an email which never gets a response, which never gets responded. So I don't exactly know what's the solution for this. If any of you come out with a solution and face such a situation and come out with a solution, please do let me know as well, because this is an unintended addition that they have done. If they wanted to really do it, they could have done it in a manner where they tell us how the validation happens. They tell us, you know, you please make sure that the bank records are updated with 1, 2, 3, 4 fields. Then probably give some time and do that. Because as you are aware, there could be bank accounts which are opened as early as 50 years back. Bankers might have been doing processes of deduplication, updation of records, etc. But still there are instances where there are some ladies who have their maiden names in the bank accounts. Their names in the PAN cards might have changed. So now you are denying them refunds only because their names have changed. So things like this. So there could be many, many more instances. So this came at the top of my mind and I said, so how do you really tackle these situations where there are refunds that are expected? You know, is a difficult task. I think you need to, you know, beware of that. Then moving ahead with the step, you know, let's say once you have pre-validated the bank account, file the returns after paying the taxes, ensure to e-verify or at least send ITRB. There have been multiple instances which have come to my notice where ITRBs were not sent and the due date for sending the ITRB got over. What's the recourse? The return becomes invalid. The only recourse is file a 119-2B condonation or delay application. And if you're lucky, the assessing officer might say, yeah, this can be allowed, because there have been a lot of times where they put a, you know, spanner in the spoke and say, no, why should it be allowed? You are not vigilant and you did not send your ITRB and all that. So in order to avoid any of that, if possible, please do Aadhaar OTP or EDC so that it gets, you know, e-verified immediately. Then track 143-1 so that your processing has been is completed, and in case there are any differences, file a 154 application, rectification application immediately online. Lot of times again there are challenges in that. I think I should quote a practical example I have. There is an SSE for whom there was a marginal relief that we claimed. Incomes was just slightly above the threshold of application of surcharge, so we did not apply the entire surcharge, we claimed a marginal relief. I don't know what's the difficulty at the CPC end. We filed multiple times rectification application. The same 143-1 comes back saying it has been rectified and no rectification takes place. So we are actually planning to file an appeal in that case, because 154 orders are appealable. So there's no other way, because grievances just get closed in a day or two without any action. 154s are not being responded. I think the only option available is to file an appeal is what we were thinking, and I think we'll be going ahead and doing that. So these kind of circumstances are there, so which, you know, practically once it comes, you'll have to find a solution for it. Then more often than not these days, you'll see there's 139-9 notices coming. There could be some validation errors that have happened. You might have done everything correctly, there was a validation error that happened, still the return got filed, 139-9 notices come. Especially it comes in cases where you filed ITR-4, presumptive income, a lot of 139-9 comes, because the validation tool that's available at ITR-4 and the validation tool available at the time of processing seems to be different. So for that reason, there have been a lot of instances where 139-9s have been issued. In case any one of them come, please track them immediately. If there are errors that have really happened from your end, correct them. File a response to the defective return, and make sure that gets corrected immediately. So this is what largely I had as far as individuals, non-resident related. Here and there I did cover the non-resident. Now I'll get into taxability of income of non-resident, and I'm focusing on individuals. Firstly, again I've put out a small chart to explain how the taxation needs to be looked at. Firstly, as you are aware, DTA has come into play, section 90, 90A or 91 comes into play when it is the case of a non-resident. Then how do you do it? First thing is scope of total income. Is the income received, deemed to be received, accrued, deemed to be accrued in India? If the answer is a no, it stops there. Those incomes are not taxable in India. If the answer to that is a yes, is there a tax treaty available between India and the country or the residence of such individual? If the answer is a no again, then provisions of the Income Tax Act applies. If the answer to that is a yes, that is there is a tax treaty available between India and the country of residence of such individual, then is the provisions of the treaty more beneficial to the taxpayer? Again, if the answer is a yes, then you apply the tax treaty subject to two things. One, having TRC, tax residency certificate, because section 90 subsection 3 talks about that TRC is mandatory for you to avail a benefit under the tax treaty. So you need to look at that. That's the first condition. The second is, it should not be subjected to GAR. So the general anti-avoidance rules. If the GAR is applicable, that is, if there is an arrangement which you have done which comes under the GAR, then tax treaty benefits are not available. So coming back, is the provisions of tax treaty more beneficial? If the answer to that is a no, then the Income Tax Act provisions apply. So this is largely the way in which incomes and the tax computation of a non-resident individual to whom a tax treaty applies is to be done. Next question comes, is it mandatory to file income tax returns for all non-residents? So, based on certain judicial precedents and practical experiences in the past, I have tried to capture this table to say that if non-resident earns incomes which are not liable for taxation because they are outside of scope of total income. So, in my chart here, if the answer to the very first question is a no, that is, those incomes are not accruing, arising, so it goes out of section 5, then you don't have to file a tax return in India. Then, if the income falls under the purview of 5, section 5, read with section 9, 9 is deeming of income, and is exempt because of tax treaty. Let's say there is a favorable provision in the tax treaty and such incomes becomes exempt. Then do you have to file a tax return in India? My personal view is you will still have to file tax returns in India. That's because I believe that you claim the relief under the treaty after going through the entire provision of the act as well as the treaty, which you need to demonstrate in the return. So hence in my view, you need to still file a return. Next question is, if there is an income which is taxable on a gross basis, that is, if there is a royalty, fee for technical services or interest or dividend which are taxable at a gross basis, then do you still have to file tax returns in India? Again, in my view, even in those circumstances, filing income tax returns are mandatory. One could come with an argument that there is a rule 37DB which says that in order to claim tax treaty relief, you don't really need to have a PAN. It's enough if you have a TRC. So in that circumstance, when there is no PAN, how are we expected to file a return? So I'm not really sure how to kind of address this issue. That's because 139.1 says that every person has to file tax returns in India. But you have a 37DB which says that maybe having PAN is not mandatory. Even if you don't have one and you have TRC, 206AA won't apply, which is the higher rate of taxation where there is no PAN, that provisions don't apply. So how do you have an interplay between the two? Is a case to case, you'll have to take a call based on practical circumstances in each case. But in my view, in case there are continuing incomes, even which are taxable under the Act, on gross basis or are exempt because of tax treaty, please advise such clients to obtain PAN in India for his tax returns in India. So that is my view on that. Moving ahead, a few incomes of non-resident, what could be there? Interest, dividend, capital gains, rental incomes, dependent personal service, independent personal service. Let me explain all of this quickly. Interest incomes and dividend incomes are generally taxed in both the countries, in the source country and in the residence country. Let me give an example. Let's say there is a foreign resident, a resident of US. He has some deposits in India, he is earning income out of that. So such interest on such deposits are taxable in India as well as could be taxable in the US because of his residence in that country. So the right to taxation is split between the two. US will give a tax credit of the India taxes paid there because he is a resident of that country. Same with the dividend. Rental and incomes arising out of real estate are typically taxable in the country in which such real estate is situated. Let's say if somebody is earning the rental income in India, they don't even need to declare that probably in the US. Of course, subject to the US tax laws. But as far as the treaty is concerned, the right to taxation is generally given to the country in which such real estate is situated. Capital gains, immovable property, again, where it is situated, the right to taxation is given to that country in typically most of the treaties. I'm slightly generalizing here. We'll have to look at each treaty to determine them. But as a general rule, I am talking here. For other properties, which are shares, etc., each treaty has a different provision. Some of them have the same thing as immovable property, some don't have like that. Some have split the right of taxation based on periods, based on quantum, and so on and so forth. DPS, IDPS, dependent personal service, independent personal service, typically applicable for individuals. I'll be covering them slightly in detail. Independent personal service, what does this mean? These are covered generally in Article 15 or in some cases in Article 14 in the DTAA. In the UN Model Convention, it is there in Article 14. So what does it cover? I'll excuse you with the differences in these two treaties. US, UK, I've just picked it up to just show you the language, how it is. Maybe I'll read one of them. To read the US one, it says income derived by a person who is an individual or firm of individuals other than a company, who is a resident of a contracting state, from the performance in the other contracting state of professional services or other independent activities of a similar character, shall be taxable only in the first mentioned state, except in the following circumstances, when such income may also be taxed in the other contracting state. What are those circumstances where it could be taxed in the other contracting state? 1. If such person has a fixed base regularly available to him in the other contracting state for the purpose of performing his activities. Then, if the person stay in the other contracting state is for a period or periods amounting to or exceeding in aggregate 90 days. These two conditions, for the sake of brevity and simplicity, I will call them the fixed base rule and the short stay exemption. So, fixed base rule is the rule where it says that those are taxable in India. Let's say there is a foreign professional who, as an individual, he is rendering services in India and those are professional services. He has a fixed base available to him in India. Such incomes are taxable in India is what it says. Or if he does not have a fixed base but he exceeds the short stay exemption, that is he stayed for more than 90 days in case of the India-US treaty, then such incomes can be taxable in India. This is what largely IDPS article is all about. What all does it cover? Well, it covers professional or other independent activities of similar character is what are the terms used. Most of the treaty, it is defined to include scientific, literary, artistic, educational, teaching, as well as independent activities of physician, lawyer, engineer, architect, dentist and accountant. Typically, this is the definition. In some treaties, there could be some inclusions into this definition. In some, there could be some exclusions into this. Again, it's an illustrative definition in most of the treaty. It is not it's an inclusive definition and an illustrative definition. There could be a lot more other professional services which can come under that. What it presumes is that for some service to fall under that, there should be an advanced level of knowledge acquired through formal training in the chosen area of practice. then such specialized skills and experiences acquired through dedicated practice, and they should be accredited or certified by a certain body like an ICAI and all that. So that is what is presumed. So where does this come out of? This comes out of the UN Model Convention. So that is, so that gives this attribution of how to kind of interpret the term professional service. So like I said, they are typically taxable in the country of residence of that individual. In my example, if there is a US resident and he is, let's say, a doctor who is rendering services in India, his incomes from that service are typically taxable in the US, unless he either has a fixed base or has stayed in India for more than 90 days. So this is the rule. Then in some cases, if the fee, so there are, you know, differences in wording, language in each treaty where there are additional rules. In Zambia, Canada treaty, there are certain additional rules. I think I will not get into detailing of them. The UN model, the commentary of the UN Model Convention says IDPS is attracted only when an individual renders services and not otherwise. If you could see the US treaty, it said firm of individuals other than company also. That's a peculiarity that is available in some treaties where they have even included firm of individuals also under the IDPS article, where they say that even if a firm of individual renders certain professional services or similar services, IDPS article is covered. If that is not covered, please note that they go under the business income article, Article 7, where only when there is a permanent establishment such gets taxable in India and all that. Professor Crossogan in his commentary states that companies and other body corporates are not covered in this. One interesting ruling I need to quote here, which is by the Mumbai Tribunal, in the case of Christian A. Nielsen, Copenhagen, where they said that the word he and his presence and the expression remuneration for labor or personal services suggests that that article of the treaty refers only to a living person, that is individual and not an artificial person such as a company. So that is what is the interpretation that was given by the Mumbai Tribunal. So it's best, you know, to ensure that you read each treaty before applying whether such non-resident individual is taxable in India because of the IDPS article or not, or does he get a beneficial interpretation based because of the treaty. Then fixed base, like I said, availability of fixed base is one of the requirements. What is fixed base? Very, very interestingly, OECD deleted the article on IDPS in the year 2000 and said that this article is very much akin to Article 7 on business income. So there is no requirement for another article called IDPS. So we don't need to have that article, and they deleted it. While deleting that, they said that fixed base, permanent establishment are almost the same terms. They are synonymous to each other. But in the Indian judiciary, since most of our treaties follow the UN Model Convention, we still have the IDPS article, and our judiciary has interpreted the term fixed base, permanent establishment quite differently. And you know, some of the differences I have pointed out here, I'll you know, skip them. Anyway, I'm leaving this presentation with the background branch, so you could refer it for your purpose. Then going into the short stay exemption. So it says that it will be taxable only if such person has stayed in India for a period of 90 days or 183 days or 120 days, depending on each treaty. Each treaty has a different threshold as to how this short stay exemption needs to be counted. So the question arises, how do we count it? If there are multiple visits, should we aggregate them? If, let's say, there is like a US treaty, there's a partnership firm, two partners are available in India, do you need to count them separately or do you aggregate them and count them? And questions like this. Again, the Mumbai Tribunal in the Clifford Chance case have brought out some very interesting arguments and observations on this. First, they said that in the context of a partnership firm, besides considering the stay of the partners in the source country, stay of employees is also to be counted. So that's a very interesting observation that they have made and ruling that they have delivered. Then they say that in calculating the period of stay, if there are multiple periods of stay in 12 months, they are to be aggregated. If they are for different projects, people keep coming, then you need to aggregate all of them to determine whether they breach the short stay exemption criteria or not. Then they they say that the common days need not be counted. Let's say there are two partners in a firm, both of them stayed for a certain project and an employee also stayed along with them. Since all of them become common days, you don't need to count the common days. You have to count the common day as one, is what they say. And it also says that during this visit, if those people are in India for purposes other than the profession for which they came, say they came here, took a small trip, so you need to exclude that while counting the number of days for the short stay exemption. So this is what comes out of this ruling. Then, so this is about professionals. Let's say there is an individual, you're filing tax return of an individual who's a, let's say, a non-resident, and you need to determine their taxability in India, compute the taxes. You need to go through whether IDPS article is applicable, apply the rules, you know, of the IDPS article of that respective treaty, and then determine the taxability. Going into DPS. DPS is typically dependent personal services, is salaries. Let's say there are expat or foreign nationals who have been deputed to India to work for a certain period as a part of their job, and you are filing their tax returns. So what is it that you will have to consider? How does it work? Sample treaty, India-UK, I have picked here. So I'll read some portions of the treaty for our discussion. The Article 16, Subarticle 1 says that subject to the provisions of 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 of the Convention, where even it could be in the nature of employment, but if it is a director's fees, artists or athletes, governmental remuneration, pensions, students and trainees or teachers, this article is not applicable. So other than that, whosoever are there for whom this article is applicable, salaries, wages and other similar remuneration derived by a resident of a contracting state, say in this case UK, he is a resident of UK, in respect of an employment shall be taxable only in that state, which is UK, unless the employment is exercised in the other contracting state, say India. If a resident of UK renders his employment in India, only then it is taxable in India. If the employment is so exercised, such remuneration as is derived may be taxed in India, is what this article reads. So then again, few things here. Second sub-article, if you see, notwithstanding the provisions of paragraph 1, remuneration derived by a resident of UK, respect of employment exercised in India, shall not be taxed in India if he is present in India for a period less than 183 days. So this again is a short stay exemption. If there is an employee of a UK company who has been deputed to, let's say, its subsidiary in India, his stay in India is less than 183 days, then though he is rendering the employment in India, his incomes are not taxable in India. Then, or if the remuneration is paid by or on behalf of an employer who is not a resident, let's say though he is deputed, but his salaries are paid by the UK parent itself, then again, he is not liable for taxation in India. Or, in case the salaries that are paid is not deductible in computing the profits of an enterprise chargeable, again he is not taxable. Let's say his salaries are not deductible from computing taxes of another person in India. It could be a company, LLP, partnership firm, so on and so forth. Then also, it will not be taxable in India. So this is what DPS article is all about. Given a comparison, Singapore, Australia, I'll skip them. So this typically is Article 15. I'll dwell a little deep into it and explain. Firstly, they are covered typically in Article 15 or 16 in each treaty. OECD Model Convention calls this article as income from employment. Then any remuneration or emolument earned while exercising the employment by the employee is taxable. For example, let's say there's a bonus that gets paid out during the period when, in which he was rendering his employment in India. So the proportion of the period where he rendered his employment in India, such bonus is taxable. Let's say there is an ESOP that was given during the period when he was in India. Such ESOPs become taxable in India. So you need to not just see what is the remuneration that is being paid out, you will also have to see what other components of salary that he has, which are akin to salary, wages or a part of that, which could also be taxable. So that is what is covered in the next point. It says that other similar remuneration, so it could include anything which are connected to wages and salaries. What are not covered is director's fees, though it could be salary, but it is not covered in this article. There is a separate article which talks about it, separate thresholds are fixed and all that. Some articles include the artisans and artists and athletes, everybody in this article, some don't. So typically, let's say Formula One, people come here, do their work, go back. So do you need to tax them? Because they might be on employment contracts with a certain company. So then do you need to tax them? Or there is a football tournament that happened, they are employees of a certain club. Please understand, if they are on a retainership with that club, it's not like that. This article doesn't apply. The IDPS article applies. Or if there is a specific article for sportsperson, that applies. If they are on employment with a club, they come to India, play a certain match, for doing that they got a certain remuneration, then do you need to cover them under the DPS article or not? Depends on each treaty. If there is no other treaty covering sportsperson's remuneration and their employees, they get covered under the DPS article. For them, again the short stay exemption and things like that are available. Then the question comes, what is wage salary? When should it be covered under this employer-employee relationship? Again, Clause Vogel says that an employer is someone to whom an employee is committed to supply his capacity to work and under whose direction the latter engages in his activity and whose instruction he is bound to obey. So the entire available hours to work, if a certain person gives it to another, so such relationship is called as employer-employee, is what Clause Vogel says. In Para 2, Article 15 of the OECD Model Convention, there are a few things which help us in understanding how this needs to be considered. Whether the services rendered by the employee constitutes an integral part of the business of the enterprise to which he provides. So if he comes as an independent individual, does something and goes, maybe there is no employer-employee relationship. So these are very fact-specific and highly factual-driven kind of assessments. So you need to do them case to case. So a few more. I have captured this based on OECD Model Convention and some rulings that have come out in this context, where they have explained there have been instances where whether that comes under the DPS article itself was questioned by the tax authority. So in order to cure that difficulty that came, it went to the courts and courts have ruled in a certain manner. So I've covered them here. Again, I'll skip talking about it in detail. Then, like I said, primary right to taxation is available with the country of residence. A secondary right is given to the country where the employment is exercised, provided a certain conditions are satisfied. That is how the DPS article typically is. Then, again, the short stay exemption, little peculiar here as compared to IDPS. The UN Model Convention says following are to be included in computing the short stay exemption. 1. Physical presence of the person in the source country irrespective of the purpose. Like I said in the IDPS article, I said that they might have been on a tour for a certain time. That gets excluded by computing short stay exemption in IDPS, but in DPS, dependent personal services, you need to cover them as well. 2. Period of holiday relaxation, if they were particularly given, that needs to be covered as well. Voluntary, non-voluntary interruptions. Let's say a foreign resident came down to India, wanted to exercise his employment in India. The factory, there was a lockout because of some labor issue. So and he had to stay without doing anything for a period of 10 days. Do you need to count that also as a part of the short stay exemption? The answer is a yes, you need to count them as well. Days lost due to factors beyond or within his control. Let's say there was a natural calamity and out of his control and he couldn't work. So do you need to consider them? The answer is a yes. Part of a day of arrival and departure also to be considered while counting the number of days. What are to be excluded? Couple of things are to be excluded. 1. Time spent in the source country to prepare for the employment. Let's say they put him on a training exclusively for rendering certain activities in India. Do you need to count them? You should not be counting them, though he's exclusively. There could be instances where he's on a transit while coming to India. Let's say one leaves a certain place in the UK and he has to take a train and come somewhere, let's say Belfast to London, and take a flight from, let's say, London to Bahrain, Bahrain to, let's say, Mumbai. So during this entire transit, do you need to count the answers? You don't need to count them. You need to count their presence only when they landed in India. So before that, even that entire transit, though it was dedicated for the purpose of this employment, you still don't have to count them. This is a very interesting thing. I'll explain it based on this example. Let's say there is one Mr. A who is deputed to India from 1st January 2019 to 31st July 2019. This, as you may see, is split amongst two financial years. Now, if you count his total number of stay, it exceeds 183 days. But if you look at it in each year, it does not exceed 183 days. Now the question comes, do you need to tax his salary which is paid to him in India? There, the important thing is, each treaty has its own rule. See, this is quite easily misusable in planning in a way like the one that I have given in this example, where it can be split over two financial years and 183 days is not crossed. In order to avoid this, off late what India has tried to do is, they have brought in the concept of rollover number of days. Let's say, even if their employment rolls over two financial years and it exceeds 183 days, even then their salaries in both the years will be taxable in India. So some of the examples of Sweden treaty and all that, where there is a rollover period of days to count. Otherwise it is typically fiscal year or tax year is the words that they use. So if you saw here, what are the exclusions for taxing in India? One is short stay exemption. Second is it is paid on behalf of a non-resident. Third is remuneration is not deductible in computing the profits of an enterprise chargeable to tax in India. Let's imagine a situation, there is a permanent establishment of a certain entity in India and the salary of that employee was borne by that permanent establishment. Then does he become taxable in India or not? Again, there are multiple ways of determining it. Since that's not the topic of discussion, that itself requires an entire session to talk about, how do you allocate, whether that permanent establishment is bearing the salary or not. There are various rules that, based on the judicial pronouncements that are, emerging. So based on that, we'll need to determine whether that is taxable in India or not. So this is the, planned content that I had to share with you today on filing of individual tax returns, including the foreign taxpayers, individuals who might be applicable, who might have taxable incomes in India and for whom filing tax returns are required in India. If there are any questions, I'll be very happy to take them. Yes, please.
In case of
filed under presumptive
taxes reasons.
Yes, sir.
He was a caterer and we received a return is not valid. We had to file the profit loss account and balance sheet.
Okay.
But mainly presenting is he doesn't maintain any
books.
How we can work with the department to carry objection?
Okay, so you filed a return under a presumptive basis.
Yes.
And you showed a gross turnover, you showed a whatever 8%, 9%, 10%, you showed it and you filed the return. What's the query that has come, sir? What is the error that has come?
The return filing is defective, you have to file the profit and loss account and balance sheet.
Okay, sir.
No, just a caterer.
Okay, so what happens, sir? There are two places in which you need to, three places which gets interlinked to each other. One, in the nature of business, you need to be very careful in choosing what is the nature of business that you have chosen. One. Second, while giving the gross receipts, there are two places that you will have to give them. If you have not given them in the right two places, then there is a mismatch that arises and it throws a defective return. So you have to be just careful about it. You file a 154, by revising those portions, it will be corrected. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Was partner than LLP.
Okay.
It was wound up about 2 years ago.
Okay, sir.
And you took an employment. And now this year I got only salary.
Okay.
But this LLP which was owned up, they are getting some compensation.
Okay.
And whatever is done by the 1 lakh.
Okay.
They are about 3 lakh rupees this year.
Okay.
Now should I still file IGR 1 for him? The salary is better than 3 lakhs.
Okay.
Should I file IGR 1 for him?
Yes, you have to file IGR 1, sir.
Where can I show this income?
Sorry, sir.
This, you have to only 1 lakh in the profit form.
Right.
They got about 3 lakh.
So you're saying there is a profit from the LLP also, which is there for him?
The share, whatever the final amount of the share. This person got about 3 lakh.
And
the LLP can share a profit when he was a partner.
That was okay.
That was because the LLP was paying the time. So now, this year he got the additional amount of 2 lakh profit.
I think I was coming to the same thing. So do you consider it to be an income from other source or an income from business or profession? If that amount that he received was because he was a partner in that LLP, I still believe it should go under section 28 and not under 56. So it is income under business or profession. So idea 1 might not be applicable in that circumstance. If for reasons based on the facts that you can determine say that I don't consider it to be taxable under 28, but it is taxable under section 56, then you probably can still file it under ITR 1.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Other lengthy, it was only for e-verification. Now it is made for
So the amount of times that it kept changing, they kept enhancing the due dates, etc. And Supreme Court finally said that nothing doing, you need to verify. So I agree with you that Aadhaar linking is mandatory.
And you told for rectification you have tried couple of times, but still same it is not processed.
Correct.
But there actually at the end of the notice, they have given instructions.
Okay.
So if you just the validation error might be there. So instead of selecting option 1, option 2, if you have selected, then it will not get processed.
No, we've actually tried all of them. We've tried all of them. See, the error is very simple. They are not given marginal relief. That's the only error. And they somehow don't seem to get her at all. And they are reprocessing by adding the entire surcharge. So let's assume that what I did was wrong, that is I chose the wrong head while filing it. But is it not that their validation rules already should have marginal relief cases? So they are directly applying a 10% surcharge while marginal relief is available to that SSE. So I really don't know why that is happening.
In the written, it will be invalid.
Yes, sir.
To be file a request.
Yes.
But is it we have to file it online?
I think now 192B applications are they are available online as well as offline. It is not mandatory; it is online, so you can choose to file it either online or offline. So there are options available for you.
It is to be for the CPC or.
Okay, so the jurisdiction to condone the delay of, let's say, giving, what is the reason for it becoming defective? Let's assume you did not submit the ITRB. Let's take that as an example. But if you have any other example, we can take that.
No, we would have posted it, but they would not have received.
They would not have received. Let's say now the jurisdiction to condone the delay is not at the CPC because there is no commissioner at the CPC level. So the jurisdiction to condone it at the jurisdictional assessing officer. So you will need to file it with the CIT of the jurisdiction for whom the taxpayer falls under. You will have to file it under the regular jurisdiction. What you will need to typically do is file an application under 192B before the commissioner, mark a copy to the jurisdictional assessing officer with all the documents, reasons why that delay needs to be condoned. Then the commissioner income tax directs a report to be submitted by the jurisdictional AO asking, in your view, should I condone this delay or not? And he submits a report. The report is not binding on CIT. CIT can take his own independent decision. If you get a personal hearing, which they typically give, if you can argue that there were genuine reasons why ITR never went, or if you have a copy of, let's say, the courier or speed post that you sent, and you can track it and say, we did send, it didn't reach there, I don't know how. So they will generally condone the delay.
One more.
Yes, sir.
See, under section PDS, usually they deduct for professional services under section
94J. Right.
But actually, they are the temporary employees.
Okay.
Then they come under regular salary or business or profession. The
sir,
two, whether it is in a business, it will come or profession.
Let me answer this separately. So first is whether they're employment or professional, then professional or business. Employment or professional depends upon the contract that they have with their employer. or the person who has paid them that money. If they have presumed that there is not employment and they have deducted under 194J, then I think it cannot be treated as salaries for employee. There is one case which had happened in the Hyderabad tribunal. I think it is very important to know. A hospital had retained doctors. So they were paying them regular every month a same sum of money and deducting TDS under 194J. The contention of the assessing officer was that it is not 194J, it had to be 192. And you had to deduct higher rates of tax because their incomes were exceeding the 10 lakh limit. They were otherwise doing a flat 10%. Hyderabad tribunal there said that these doctors are retained in such a way that they follow the entire code of ethics of their hospital. Then they are throughout the day available in the hospital itself. They are virtually operating like employees. Hence, irrespective of the contract, I will go by substance over form, and they held it that it is taxable as salary. So, for the employees that you are referring to, maybe you will have to look at that to see whether you know it is really professional services or employment. The first test is the employer himself has already considered them to be professional, so you can take that stand unless there are facts and documentation available which are contrary to that. So I hope I answered the first one. To come to the second one, whether it is profession or business, I think the word profession is defined under the law. So if it falls within that, it comes in a profession. If it is not, it is business.
I wanted to say, is to satisfy the definition of profession.
Yes, sir.
Otherwise you can
take it as business. Irrespective of whether it is deducted under 194J, that cannot determine whether it is business or profession.
CPC will come back saying that it is not a business.
So, I think there is a mismatch between the way the CPC is working and the income tax law is working in some circumstances like this. I think the only by way of consultation they should actually solve this problem. We can only hope we can keep filing some, in your case you can probably file an appeal and see if you can get a directions to them. So that's the only way out, sir. Otherwise, unfortunately, there's nothing you can do about it. Because the ones that you interact with at the CPC are all employees of, let's say, Infosys or somewhere who don't know the law in its original form. So they just are given templates for this question, you have to answer this way. And they continue to do it that way. That's all.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
For CPC.
Yes, sir.
Is there a time limit or something for completing permission? Somebody has filed a return last year online.
Okay.
Share a profit from a firm which is actually subject to audit under Section 1.
Okay, sir.
Then even now, that person has got, the partner hasn't got that assessment order yet.
So the 143, the intimation has not come.
Not yet come.
Yeah,
when we check the status online, it is actually filed, everything is fine.
Correct.
But then, even though it is more than that, but last year, October, I guess it was fine.
Okay.
But as of now, nothing has come, no other communications.
Actually, 143.1 says that there is no mandate by when they need to process the return. It's a recommendatory rule. They say that within 1 year, you need to process it. Unfortunately, what happens even beyond a year, sometimes it doesn't get processed. I don't really know the reason. When it was manual, I still can understand that there is a humongous effort they need to process each return. Today, when it is CPC, it should be that much more easy. One way out, sir, is probably submit a grievance in the CPC portal stating that it's a very simple process. Just state that ITR processing has not happened despite you filing the return on so-and-so date. So, based on that grievance, they might act. Such simple grievances they do take up and they act on it. Something which is related to refunds and all that, they just don't do it.
Thanks a lot. Is just because of the volume that they have got to handle?
I don't agree, sir. So when they are aware of the number of taxpayers that are there in this country, they need to be prepared for the volumes that are there. So if they are not prepared for it, unfortunately, that's wrong.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, so this is a question on disclosure of income from debt-oriented mutual fund or from debentures,
okay,
which are taxable at the normal rate.
All right.
Understand that in the return, there is a dilemma where to show it. Show it under other category because the capital gain, first two, three parts relate to the loyalty, you know, tax.
The 115, 111A and all that. Yeah. So where you show this is the dilemma which is there. I agree with your dilemma, sir. That is not a clear thing which is there in the ITR. I would suggest you should, in the capital gains, there is a place where you can show other assets. My suggestion is to show there that other assets column when you put it, it will not presume it for whatever the gross based taxation of 10%, the special rate based taxation, it doesn't pick there. So in my view, it is better to show it in the other category in the capital gains. In 112A, there is a complete exemption.
Less than 1 lakh.
Okay.
So not less than 1 lakh. It is a this fair market value as on 1/1/2018 is
same as the sale price. So where do you show?
Yeah.
So the answer to that is it's not an exempt income. It's just that the capital gain is nil.
Yeah.
So you will have to still show it under the capital gain head to say the sale consideration is 100. Let's say the cost of acquisition is also 100. Capital gain is nil. It's not an exempt income. So if it is an exempt income, you put it under the schedule EI where it shows the exempt incomes. Otherwise, you need to still put it under the capital gains column. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Krishna sir, for valuable insight on income tax returns applicable for individuals and foreign taxpayers. Couple of announcements. So as I already told at the beginning of the session, so budget and unit budget analysis will be there in Best College. So it is 29th unit budget analysis of Bangalore Bench. It is most prestigious. So please do attend the seminar without fail. And also we have on 13th July one day seminar on charitable trusts on Saturday in Vasanagar premises itself. So and also on 19th and 20th of this month we have clause by clause discussion on unit budget. So one day is on direct taxes, one day is on indirect taxes at RJ Royal Conventional Hall near ISKCON Temple. So you can register online in Bangalore Bench ICA app and also in website. So please do register yourself. So now I request on behalf of Bangalore Bench CS Aram Bhatt sir to please present the memento. And also I request Srinivas sir to join. Thank you, Krishna sir, for your valuable time. And I, last but not least, I thank you each and everyone. In spite of no sleep, you also made your, you have taken your time and attended here. So thank you so much for attending this session.